So anyone else, or have I scared you? Yes, this lady, and then you at the back.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
First time I'm attending this. Thank you. I'm an educationist.
Right.
And supposed to be handling certain sessions on management students on corporate sustainability. Mm-hmm. Therefore, they are right now creating a kind of a curriculum.
Curriculum development. That would fall under education.
For this thing. So what they are thinking, the colleges are thinking, is not to do this as a mandate, but the dil ki baat, that it has to come from the heart for the students. Is there any way you would be able to help towards this cause?
As in which way do you want me to help? I'm not a corporate.
No, you are not a corporate, I understand.
Yes.
But to suggest to the management institutes towards the development of a curriculum, is there anybody who has done a kind of a curriculum to teach them?
Teach them on what?
Corporate sustainability, under which comes CSR.
Okay, so some thought will have to be applied to that. I may not be able to have a ready answer
for
you.
No, because this is, I'm looking at it from a different perspective. This is a mandate.
I understand, yes.
But if it comes from within every student of this country, then it becomes...
To develop a curriculum.
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine.
That's right.
Let's talk about that. I mean, it's a little outside the purview of the session here, so you accept that. Yeah. Yes, ma'am, at the back. Go on, I can hear you.
CSR funding.
First of all, there are three kinds of social enterprise. Basically, a social enterprise is often a pure business. But who says that some social good happens? In that sense, Tata Steel was India's first social enterprise. We make hospitals, we make schools, but we also make steel. Okay? Social enterprise. Social enterprise can be for-profit, non-profit, or hybrid. The hybrid is the worst model, if you ask me. I mean, because you are neither here nor there. If you are a non-profit social enterprise, that means registered either as a trust, society, or a section, by all means, you'll qualify. But if you are a private limited, your chances of, because the rules very clearly said who can be your implementing agency. You have to be a trust, society, or a section 25, or section 8, as they call it now. So you would not probably be seen as an implementing agency for, but they might directly fund some of your activities. But companies would be a little cautious in this regard, considering what the rules state as of the moment. They have nowhere explicitly mentioned social enterprises. Social enterprises, by and large, are seen as for-profit models, but trying to do some social good. So wait and watch. As of the moment, I would say companies would keep you on hold. They wouldn't say no to you either, because companies do like the idea of a social enterprise, but the rules are framed such that it clearly specifies who can be your implementing. You certainly cannot claim to be their implementing agency. But let us say you are a social enterprise is making, let us say, solar lanterns. They can buy that from you and gift it to, or give money to an NGO to buy your solar lanterns to go into the villages and light them up. So there will be various ways in which that can be done. So it's how you will pitch yourself to the company that is more important. Have I answered your question? Yes, ma'am, I'll come to you. Yeah, give it to this lady, please. And there may be some outside also, so we will try to, yeah, sure.
Hi, I have two questions specifically. Yes. Now in large scale projects, they are asking also companies, especially from a CSR perspective, ask extensive reporting system.
Of course.
Down to daily reporting literally. So can an NGO budget some amount in the project for monitoring and evaluation?
There is nothing specific to debar you, as long as it is a reasonable amount based on a percentage. So let us say 5% again, or 10%. I would say nothing more than 10%. I would say 5% would be very safe. If 5% of this is allocated for monitoring and evaluation, the law certainly will not hold the companies wrongly for that, because end of way, if it is running into several crores, you obviously want to know whether you are on track or not. So most certainly you can provide funding for M&E.
And second question is, branding and marketing being used through CSR is something companies are doing often under CSR. But I have a specific company which has approached one of the NGOs I work with, where they want to set up solar grids, micro grids, and make the local community pay out of it and earn some money. But the installation is...
So it's not a direct charity. Yeah. I mean, there is a value that is put on the product.
Is something like that allowed, I mean, from an NGO?
Let me put it this way. It is not specifically disallowed either. And the law principle is very simple. What is not specifically disallowed is automatically allowed. Unless the negative list will come someday. Right now you are not in the negative list. What is not CSR? So they might seize your example and they'll probably put up a circular saying, you know, this is not CSR. So the negative list over the years will increase. I can guarantee you that. This is your one.
Thanks.
Who else? Somebody, yes, this lady.
A question is, like, suppose I'm a company, a bit limited company or whatever, but I'm not an NGO, but I'm providing a service to a foundation, let's say in terms of recycling water, sanitation, that's my domain knowledge. And so they've hired me to provide this service and they would be implementing it. Does the cost for my staff get exempt under CSR?
Just because you are doing this, your staff gets exempted.
Yeah, the staff that's working on the project, no.
No.
So
it's like many a time NGOs come that, can my staff be exempted from Employees Provident Fund Act? Should they be paying TDS? Of course you have to. I mean, because you're working in NGO.
No, I'm saying for the company, let's say the cost comes to X amount for implementing the project, but I'm not an NGO. They're actually hiring the services of a consultant to roll out. So that service, would that come under the 5%?
Yes, it would come under for under capacity billing. 5% of the 2%.
Of the 2%. Thank you.
It would certainly come under that.
Sir,
in fact, when I advise companies, this is the question that for the advice that my organization gives the company, can we pay out of that 5%? And I always say, yes, please do it that way only.
Setting up our schools, colleges, university, or extending a new discipline of a branch of education in some of the university can be the part of CSR?
Of course. It is covered under Schedule 7. We have already dealt with that.
If an NGO is to be an implementing agency in the current year, it should have done the activity for
3 years.
Only
activity is talked about. It's not talking of registration for 3 years, thankfully. So if you have been active for the last 3 years and give some reasonable proof of activity over 3 years, you could be an implementing agency for a CSR mandated company.
But it should be in existence for 3 years.
There must be activities for the last 3 years. Because, you know, many NGOs get a registration application put, but they don't get it for 1 year, but they continue with their activities. So that is the requirement. Anyone else? CRISIL rating, what about it? No, I'm sorry. What about CRISIL rating? I don't get it.
Sir, I want to ask you one question that, under this CSR, one of my eye specialist doctor was taking his team to remote places. That means the transport charges, other charges comes into picture. Because that expenditure on this transport was so much that company says that this one something got disallowed. And then he has made other way around, that on certain days of month in his hospital, that he will allow the patients to come to do that his work. Okay. So therefore, I want to just know that how that expenditure is
Let me put it this way, that let us say a company is interested in disaster relief in Kashmir. So there are a lot of people who are dying over there. They need medical facilities. From the CSR budgets, I mean, which is for healthcare, they could definitely pay for the doctors to be flown to Kashmir and all that. No, I don't think the Ministry of Corporate Affairs would have any problem with that. It wouldn't be seen as an admin cost to fly a doctor over there to Kashmir to treat people who have been affected by the floods over there. From whatever I know from my dialogue with the ministry, it would not be a problem.
That is once in a while, because it is a
Yes.
It is It is not, it doesn't take place every now and day.
So let us say it's a very remote village where you have to go to and fro. Any reasonable expense or sending these specialists over there, you can put it as part of the project expense. It would not be a problem.
No. It was taken, means that the company didn't get some proper that tax benefit or something like that. And then they have to stop that. Giving expenditure to that eye camp. Then doctor was philanthropic enough that he made other way around that they can come to his hospital and he will operate this one. I just wanted to know, because this eye camp and medical camp on which that
it would come under healthcare and preventive healthcare
expenditure.
It is. Yeah. Okay, sir. Yes, it definitely falls under CSR. Under preventive healthcare and healthcare both.
My question was, I think recently I heard that this CRISIL rating of the NGOs will definitely help them to get...
They are trying to get into it and I hope they don't. Because the parameters which are used for corporates, if they will use that corporate ideology to bring it on the NGO sector, I'm all for evaluating NGOs, but I'm not for rating and grading them. Because, you know, there are NGOs that are 50 years old and there are 5 months old NGOs. There are big, medium size, small. Of course, companies, it can be said the same thing, that there are big companies, mid-size, SMEs and all that. But I would still think that a for-profit model is very different from a non-profit. And I would hope CRISIL won't bring its corporate wisdom in that sense to the NGO sector. This is my personal opinion and I can be wrong and I'm maybe being controversial here. But I think if there is any rating, etc., it must come from within the sector. I mean, I would be averse to... But I've been hearing this for at least the last 2 years of CRISIL and other rating agencies getting into the sector to rate NGOs, that you would give them a AAA rating or something like that. And so this is a AAA NGO, etc. I would be a little wary of it. I mean, with great respect. Yes, sir. You had a...
Another thing is that with regard to employee engagement. So, I want to know, like, how do you budget it?
It was meant, but that's taken away now. So, what you can do is, and this is what I've been telling companies, is employee engagement is a great thing. All over the world, especially in the US, etc., employee engagement is... In fact, employees join companies which are engaged in this kind of work. They prefer to work with such companies. What I've told these companies, it won't count as CSR, but when you write your CSR report, you can write under miscellaneous. That first comply with what 135 wants, and then say beyond what 135 wants, we also run this.
But that sometimes there are some companies with whom you do not have a particular CSR collaboration, but they want to engage with you. So, I don't know how you take that into account.
As the law stands right now, it cannot be taken into account as in under 135, because 135 is reduced to arithmetic, I repeat. 2% of your last 3 years and how have you spent it? That is the first part. Everything else you do is miscellaneous.
Thank you.
So, you can certainly do that. So, you can say we have been running blood donation camps. Our employees are regularly giving blood donations, etc. But does it come under 135? Answer is no. But it's a good activity your company is running. Don't stop it. But can you calculate 2% of the blood donation? You can't. Can you put a value on the blood? You can't put a price on the blood. Let's say you can certainly put a value on the blood, but you can't put a price on it. Yes.
Sir, you would like to undertake a project of 25 lakhs for project in Northeast. How to go about funding? What are the sources of funding?
There could be government funding, there could be foundation funding for your kind of work, or there could be some companies who might be interested in things
like
that.
How do we know this? We have to negotiate or talk to them. How to go about?
First, you have to identify companies who might be interested in your search. Okay. As of the moment, that data information is not ready. As I told you that this act has come into force only less than half a year ago. Okay. It has come into force from 1st April.
Okay.
Over time, data and information will be available on the Ministry of Corporate Affairs website, on the Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs. Over time, all this data, but as of the moment, there are certain spurious directories going around, which say that these are the companies you can approach for CSR funding, but it is a lot of baloney. Don't go for it.
Thank you.
So right now that is still in the process of being put together.
Sir, sorry, I'm a little confused. Implementing agency, does it have to have a track record for 3 years? Because it's just registered trust, right? They've just clarified it subsequently.
They said having activities for the last 3 years is what the rules say. The CSR rules say having activities for the last 3 years. It's not very, now assuming a company deals with a company that is not exactly 3 years active. Again, I would say that the company won't be faulted for that. As long as CSR is done, as I say, they are not minutely going to audit CSR. As of the moment, there is no provision for that. As long as actual genuine good work will be done, it's fine. So basically, this rule is brought to keep away fly-by-night operators. That, you know, it's not somebody who is just created because CSR has come. They want to see your track record. It's under FCRA also. Until you are 3 years old, you won't get FCRA registration. Same rule, more or less. They want to see whether you are fly-by-night or you are genuine. That's about it. So let's say it's a genuinely good organization and is a little less than 3 years old. A company won't be faulted for making them their CSR partner. It is not contemplated to that strict level under the Act or the rules.
Sir, what caution we should take when we are taking funds through agencies like Give India and other agencies?
Oh, they have a agreement, no? Generally, when they give it to you. I don't know. I mean, you have to just read the fine print very clearly. For that matter, forget why name Give India. Any foundation giving you, whether it's a Ford Foundation or a Tata Trust, read the grant agreement very carefully. Sometimes they make you sign things which you realize only later. You know, some grant agreements say that if you have underperformed, you will return the money, even the money that you have spent. Because according to them, you have underperformed. It is at your risk and consequence. What you sign in your grant agreement, then you will be bound by that. And trust me, some of the best foundations make you sign things which you would never want to. So we sign blindly because 10 crores is coming our way, let's sign it. You don't read the fine print which is involved there. It says you have already spent 1 crore, but by their standards you have underperformed, you have to return that 1 crore to them. So be very careful what you sign. Today, whether it's a Give India or a Tata Trust or a May, they will sign a grant agreement with you between the grantor and the grantee. Read the grant agreements very, very carefully. And if you are not comfortable with something, negotiate with them. Tell them that we find this very unfair. You have a choice to refuse the grant, make them negotiate, or this is it. So it will all depend on what you have signed as part of your grant agreement.
Sir, I have two questions. One is generally the CSR, the company spend on, they observe the events, the international events like Women's Day or the Environment Day, and they conduct some activities accordingly.
So one-off activities are not counted from what we just saw in the rules. One-off events are generally discouraged for the purpose of CSR.
But if they have conducted, like for example, World Health Day, and they have conducted some camps.
So camps are more in the project mode, so that would be fine.
That would be fine. And another question is the CSR people, like the company is hiring the CSR people. You are saying it is going in administration, but some of their time is if they are spending on the field, monitoring of the programs.
Up to 5% of the 2% they can be paid out.
But it will not come under program cost, the monitoring cost of those.
The company would have to give them salary from outside their CSR budget.
Okay, so
they would have to give it from their other budgets.
So it can be in a program, project kind of layout.
What is required is that you have to set aside 2%. And what you spend on admin costs out of that must be restricted to 5% of that amount which is calculated. Supposing you want to hire a CSR staff, but the amount available here at the rate of 5% is very low, the company can give it from its other budgets. I mean, the company has lots of resources, so they can just engage somebody as part of their HR hiring. So the HR department will just directly hire and pay from the company's regular accounts, not from its CSR funds. That's one way to do it. This gentleman has? Oh, yes. So I'll take Sucheda's as the last question.
This is not a question, just a little bit of information. Media report said that MC did some internal estimation exercise, and they, you know, revised it downwards. So now they are saying total spending in this first year implementation, and some people saying we don't have enough, things. Now they are closer to 5,000 crore. So that is the figure. figure?
No, I think they have not come down as low as 5,000 crores. They have brought it down to 16,000 crores is what I last heard. The 20,000 was a little bit of an exaggeration.
No, I'm talking of something a week back in 2-3 even media reports and on the internet. From the 16,000 crores, which KPMG and all said, internal exercise says now it's closer to 5,000. After the 16,000 crores.
Let's not get carried away by these figures. I've always said that this is potentially a source, but don't get too excited about it. Yes, Sucheta?
No, I think we should. It's time. Thank you for a very, very wonderful session. I think we should all give Noshir a huge, big hand. Thanks.